Well, good afternoon, everybody. Annie back here again. As you can see, I'm keeping track. if you're a shell collector, you're always into keeping information. So from now on, I'm going to have a little tag here that says the date and what the weather is and little pertinent stuff. So today, it was kind of cool, temperature-wise, but positive cool because it was snowing out. And I love snow. Not everybody does, but I love snow. So here we are. It's a spring snow, those big fluffy snowflakes. So as you know, a lot of my relationships goes back to with Native American things. So I'm going to just read just a little bit from something I wrote. In 1993, I began to write, and it just seems appropriate to read this so you get a little feel for where I'm coming from when it comes to snow. So last night I had a dream, and this is because we had the snow coming down today. High in the sky, I saw a mighty eagle. All around him, large, fluffy flakes of snow were slowly drifting to the earth below. The mighty eagle was keeping company with them. I felt as if they knew each other, that they were brothers. The mighty eagle began to mirror the movements of one particular snowflake. The eagle and the snowflake seemed to be dancing together. The whole sky filled with unbelievably beautiful music as they danced. It was as if their dance was giving birth to the music itself. So gentle and peaceful were the music and the dance that tears of joy began to fill my eyes. As I watched and listened, it was as if my own spirit had joined with theirs and was now a part of the dance, the gentle, peaceful dance of harmony. I felt as if my heart would burst in its joy. Well, you'll be hearing more from that, but that's just to get us started. Obviously, this is the last day of March. I'm not going to do any April Fool's stuff ahead of time, but a lot going on in the world and in my world. And I think I mentioned last week about Myron's son, Black Elk's descendant, being shot. And this has gone a little bit, quite a bit farther. He's still in the hospital. In a coma. And one of the things that's transpired is that in Rapid City, the hotel where the shooting took place, the owner said she doesn't want any more Indians there, so she barred Indians being able to come and be in the hotel and in the restaurant. So what it did is it precipitated the Indians all coming together. And now they're filing suit on her for trespassing because the Black Hills really belong to them. So you might want to look it up. There's a lot going on in that. I was also something to see the Oscars and the where a bad joke like a slap created, well, to return it in a physical form. So those are things that I myself, as not just somebody who makes shells, but somebody that finds herself doing a lot of knowing on Native American issues and other things, I can't not have it here with us today. So we're going to stop talking about that. Just needed you to know that's in my mind. So my granddaughter yesterday, she lives up in Juneau, Alaska, and she's my little great-granddaughter, just turned 5. And she said, I want to know all your outdoor stories. So one of the stories I told her, and maybe I'll do that, this particular one, I made it up. I made this, I told Myron, I don't know what to do with the stress. So I said to him, I'm going to put some bright colors together and I'm going to make shells. And then Myron's Junior can give that to people when he's out of the hospital. We're just going to keep that hope in mind. So as I do that, I'm going to tell you about the Smokies. When I was a little girl, probably about maybe 6 or 7, we went to the Smokies. Now, I don't know what kind of car we had, but obviously I was in the back seat. There were no seat belts. And our little Cocker Spaniel Shadow, black, we were in the back. And we pulled up in the night to the campground. And this is way, way back. I mean, I think we're talking about 1950 in the national park. And there's this enormous roaring sound going on. And you got to think, I'm only 6 or 7. I don't know what it is. And I'll bet you my folks didn't know what it was either. They maybe had a clue, but... And it was, like I said, really dark. And then we get out of the car. And I didn't have any brothers and sisters, and so I bounce out with my dog. And everything's wet. It's not raining anymore, but everything's really wet. But beyond, there's this big roaring sound. And I have not a clue what it is. My folks don't say anything. They're busy unpacking. And they set up the tent. Now, it's one of those umbrella tents. And when I say an umbrella tent, it's almost literally like an umbrella. The post is in the middle, and you push it up. And for the rest of the time, you got your bedding in there and your cots and stuff, and you're continually walking around. Now, Robin, have you ever heard those kind of tents? Okay, you've never tented unless you've been in an umbrella tent. I've got to say, I love tents. So when I go in a store, you know, like one of those outdoor stores, or when magazines come out or the ads come out, they all got these tents. Oh, I want to buy every tent I see. Yeah. And I had a little tent, by the way. Actually, it was my folks' tent. And this was a tent from the Second World War. And it had an entrance that you had two entrances to it. You went in almost like an airlock, just like you go into the space station. And then it had a little air thing at the top. It was very, very cozy, just two of us kids could get in it. And so on one side, it was all army green. And then the other side, it was all white. It was reversible. It was meant to be if you wanted to go out in the snow and not be seen by the enemy. So camping's been in my blood since I was a little squirt. Well, my folks got the tent all set up, and we climb in there, and we go to sleep. And I go to sleep with this roaring sound. Loving that. And in the morning, I wake up. It's quiet outside, and I go outside in the sun, and I find out what it was all about. We are right next to a mountain stream. And in the night, what was happening with all that rain, it was a torrent coming down. But by that time, it had stopped. And for 2 weeks, and I gotta tell you, there wasn't very many people there, I had this stream all to myself. I was in heaven. There was hemlocks on either side and rosebuds, and just so dear to me. So for 2 weeks, I'm playing in those streams. One of the things that happened is I'm a little kid, and they kind of let me do whatever I wanted. And I'm sure they watched me a lot closer than I thought. But one day I got stuck in a little creek, a little waterfall. And being only 7, I was kind of scared. How am I supposed to get out of this? And there's my dad. My dad's looking at me. And he doesn't do anything to help me. It's like, what's going on here? And I finally got myself out of it. Well, years later, when I'm all grown up, my dad and I talk about it. Well, it turns out he was trying to teach his daughter that she could get out of things on her own. And maybe that's where I'm at here. I do things the way they seem right for me to do. Now, I may say a lot of things when I'm making these shells that maybe some of you will find very hard. But remember I said this clay is kind of my companion. That's why it was kind of hard to hear all this stuff going on. But one of the interesting things is that with the Godfather premiere and having been there, and this line from the Godfather being made offers you can't refuse, I realized a couple days ago that these Native people who are saying about the trespassing, what they're doing they are refusing. You know, they were made an offer in 1980 when the Supreme Court said it was their land and they refused the money. And so they were made an offer the United States government didn't think they could turn down, even though they were so poor. So amazing how things turn out. So I will be writing essays on that. So just giving you a little clue. There was somebody who wrote something similar to that, and so I did send that thought to her. So, and all of you that are listening to this, see now, sometimes what happens is the clay isn't mixed good enough. I've got one of these that's not, is a different strength, so it's not working good. So if I were on the beach and I saw this shell, it would probably interest me because it's not perfect. A lot of people collect shells that have imperfections in them, especially if one of the things that happens to a snail is sometimes something will actually get a hold of it and break it, and then the snail can repair it. And you'll find a repair on a snail, on the shell. So I'm going to keep that one as for that, just that same reason. Well, I was said, you watching this, I'm wondering what you're doing. I'm wondering what you're like. I would appreciate, once you see these videos, I would love feedback to know who's reading these and watching them and knowing. It's a two-way street. I never tire of seeing all those colors coming together. Remember we were talking about unity and diversity, yeah. Enormous amount of prayers going up right now for Ukraine. Can't imagine what it's like for those people. There's a passage in the Bible that I like. It's something to the effect that when we can't pray, that the Spirit prays through us. And I think maybe the world is in that place right now. Things going on, like with climate and what's happening in Ukraine, and so many things that it's as if we're needing to just relinquish being able to even know how to pray. Well, one thing I told, I said to Dan about today, it's time that I got down to something serious, although this is serious, about a practical issue. I started writing about 35 years ago and on Native American justice issues. And I've never been with a college. I don't have any, there's no funding that I have. For 10 years, I delivered newspapers while I did my writing. Once I got married, my husband Phil said, why don't you let me help you on the support part and write. But that's still difficult. So one thing I want you to know, everything that I'm making here is for sale, except for these that I just did. And remember I said something about collecting. Now, imagine I did these all on one day, and at some point I'm going to give them a name. I need to name my color combinations. But with everything else, I haven't gotten around to it. And there are some color combinations I really like. For some reason, I really like brown and pink together. They are, you know, you'd think about brown and pink together, and lo and behold, they're very, very pretty. I really like them. So that's the way I see collecting these shells, is collecting the day I make them, but also the color combinations. And like this one, I've got the snail to go with it, and here's a necklace. Now what I did is I put the long spiraled shell here, and the flat one, I put them together. So it's kind of, I like the symbolism. Now today, I thought I would talk about negative space with my shells. Now, in Florida, there's a real popular shell, a Wendel trap, and that means staircase in Dutch. And I'm Dutch, so it fits. So you can see the Wendel trap has it where it comes out, and in order to do it, I did it with a negative space. Yeah, I'd be interested to hear if who even remembers Mr. Alexander before Bob Ross. It's almost I'd love to have a Mr. Alexander club, a fan club. He's passed away, but it's just that he had such a joyous way about him. Now, I want you to imagine here's this shell. And how do I get that in there? Well, guess what? I had to sneak this into the library. Of course, I probably didn't get any trouble if I did. It's not a knife that's going to hurt anybody. But I start at the top, and I start moving down. And I've got to say, I don't know how I knew to do this. It's just, it's creativity and where ideas come from are really strange. Online, I have a lot of different things I follow. One is called Colossus, and it's artwork by all sorts of people. And also love to go on, Pinterest. And oh, some of the artwork that is there, ideas. And I do realize that a lot of you also are artists or creators, so I would love to know what you do. And who knows, this may generate somebody else to feel like, even though they're shy, well, maybe I can do this too. You know, your kids and your grandkids would love to hear you just sharing the little details of your life. So obviously this is for public people to know, but this is so much about my grandkids, my great grandkids. That's why I bring up Allie. she was saying she was having a bad day, but it was raining outside, and she said, I went outside, and as soon as I got outside, I felt better. And that's me. I love the rain. I love the snow. So especially today, I think about you, Allie. Yep. I've only got two granddaughters. The rest are boys. And then I've got, golly, how many granddogs and grandcats around? And one is my daughter Catherine's dog, and little Franz. And Franz is what they call an American Eskimo, I guess. But he's a German dog, and oh, the most friendliest little dog. So you can see how what it did. It took made a negative space. I don't know if you know that I also make animals. And today I thought, why not? So today I brought in some clay. And the shells and the animals, they're like my twins. When I was doing my writing back from 85 or 87 on, I had this clay with me. And it became a stress reliever for me. And Robin, I think you've seen me do this before. Or not?
An elk or snails?
Have you seen me do the animals?
I don't think so.
You haven't?
I've actually seen the final result.
Oh my, okay.
Annie, you don't have to talk about it right now, but if you could talk a little bit about the connection between what's going on right now with Black Elk's descendant and what you feel like was the warning from your time with the Godfather, with Marlon Brando.
Say that again?
Can you talk about the connection between the Godfather and what's going on right now with Black Elk's descendant?
Okay, well, the Godfather, we went to the premiere. Did I talk about this last week or not?
You did, yep. So okay. We have a bit about like how you went to the Godfather and that experience. But your takeaways and how it's perhaps still a problem that needs to be addressed.
Okay. Well, one of the big things with movies, if they're really good and they've got things that are quotable in them, they love to take them out. And the quotable remark in The Godfather is that horse's head. There was a movie producer, and the Godfather's son wanted to be in a movie, and the producer wouldn't let him in the movie. And so this producer had this beautiful racehorse called Khartoum, named after a city. And what he did is he had somebody sneak in there and cut the horse's head off and put it on the bed, making him an offer he couldn't refuse. Well, for a long, long time, when you know Indian issues, you realize that Native people have been, with all the treaties, they were offered, I wouldn't say they were offered, they were put in a place to have to sign treaties. And it wasn't a fair exchange. So obviously, having been very close with Marlon and all of the thing on Indian issues, I've used that quite often about Native people being made offers they couldn't refuse. Well, a couple days ago, Phil and I were talking about it, and obviously the thing with Chris Rock and the joke that came up, it got me thinking, and it made me realize, here were these Native people, you know, after Myron's son got shot, the hotel owner decided to say, they can't be here. I don't want any Indians in here. I don't want this anymore. And what happened is these Native leaders, they all came together, and they realized they could say to her, and they've officially made it formal, that she's trespassing. Well, the long and the short of it made me realize In 1980, when the Supreme Court said that the Black Hills, according to the treaty back in 1868, they really still own the Black Hills. And I realize, as poor as the tribes are, they refuse the offer, you know. So I'm so proud of them for, over these 42 years, of having the strength to refuse that money and keep the United States honest. And keeping that land as much sacred in their own, underneath their loving care. It's a hard thing. I can't translate it. So you can see why the clay's been so good to me, because I could put some of my stress in the clay. Now, I'm not so crazy about the colors I got in this one, so what am I going to do? Wake it up a little bit here. I would also love to know how many of you use polymer clay and what you do with it. I would just love to see people making these shells and trading them with people. Oh, boy. So, Robin, does that make a little more sense? Right now, it hasn't gone very far. Somebody picked it up in the New York Times. I did write the journalist. I haven't heard back. So I've been contacting journalists all over the place, asking for prayers for my son. So this is what I've done. I take and make it look like marble. And then instead of taking a hard piece of marble, I have a soft piece of marble. So instead of taking away or adding, when you do with clay, either take away or you add to it, I transform it. So I often talk about bad habits or anything that we have that we don't like. Well, maybe it's something just that wants to get it transformed. Applies to me as much as anybody else. So I hopefully you can see that line of color. Now, I want you to know I'm right-handed. I cannot do this with my right hand. So apparently what happens psychologically is the stress goes into my left hand and comes out, transformed. So in a way, my art, these animals, are my stress transformed. My pain transformed into peaceful animals. So on deeper issues, I mean, just think about it. You know, our country and our world, we have things like this. We really need people from all walks of life with ideas. I'm just one person with some concepts, but we've all got ideas. So not, you've never seen me do this.
It's adorable.
Well, one of the things, I think I mentioned before about Frito-Lay and them, or was it Lay's potato chips, yeah, about the a salt and fat delivery system. Well,